It's always been a nightmare of mine, getting kicked out. When I was a kid, I had this weird obsession with dreaming about being thrown out, which didn't make sense because my parents are good people. And yet my younger self saw them as terrible monsters. My mom and dad supported me through my childhood, but still. There I was, dreaming my father was throwing me onto the streets at 7 years old with nothing but my SpongeBob backpack, spilling an unnecessary amount of books and a dozen candy bars. It was always snowing in my dreams, and I was ankle deep in the stuff, but I was never cold. It's a well-known fact that you can feel what happens in your dreams. Whether it's being stuck in a flurry of swirling white snow or being stabbed in the gut by the boogeyman under your bed. I never felt the cold of the snow or the numbness of my bare fingers and toes. I didn't feel anything. There was never a reason for these dreams. I loved my parents and my vanilla life of playing with dolls and arguing with my brother over whose turn it was on the PS3. In my mind, I knew I was safe. I had parents that loved me and a roof over my head. I would always have that security. The dreams didn't scare me, but they did make me wonder if there was something wrong, deep, deep down. That wasn't normal for a 7-year-old, right? I remember being into the Nancy Drew books, anything which was mystery or fantasy. Of course, read to me by mom, I ate it up. All those imaginary worlds fascinated me and I was bored with my own mundane life. Maybe I craved my very own adventures, like the ones in those fictional worlds. Or I was a fucking psychopath. I don't know. I never really thought about it again. Until 11 years later. Isaac, I knocked again, harder this time. Let me in. I was surprised how calm my tone was considering the situation. I'd already been having a pretty shitty day. Sleeping through my alarm was bad, but I wasn't ready for what the day had in store for me. I'd managed to forget my jacket in sub-zero temperatures, been yelled at in class for not fully paying attention, and then I'd had to present a group presentation on my own after my teammates bailed on me last minute. That went as well as you would expect, considering I'd done all the work the night before, which was the primary reason why I was so out of it. The cherry on the top of my day from hell came much later when I found myself locked out of the student house I shared with three others. I'm not going to say there was no reason for kicking me out, because there was. I wasn't paying. At least, I had been paying until I'd lost my part-time position at the coffee shop down the road. Mom and Dad were struggling, so asking them was out of the question. I had to make a decision: eating or paying rent. It's pretty obvious which one I chose. I thought I'd be able to get a job, but after 100 seconds of applications sent out and no replies, not even a hint of interest, I was starting to lose hope. So, yes, I could understand why I'd been thrown out. What I couldn't understand, however, was why there had been no warnings. I'd been expecting them since I owed maybe 2 months, but there'd been nothing. Sorry, Lou. My housemate didn't sound sorry. We're under strict instructions not to let you in since you ain't been paying. He'd been keeping quiet until I'd changed tactics, instead slamming my fists into softwood. I'd already grabbed the handle, but somehow it felt wrong, especially when I knew it wouldn't fucking open. Isaac had made sure of that. His words were final. I had to clamp my mouth shut to swallow a frustrated screech. I wasn't going to beg. I wasn't going to tell him I'd been struggling to live on canned food and ramen for almost 2 months, that I could barely afford necessities. Isaac, it's freezing. Yeah, it's pretty cold. Well, can you let me in? I snapped. I need to get my stuff. He was quiet for a moment before opening the door and slipping something through the gap before slamming it shut in my face. It's easy to hallucinate when you've barely had any sleep. The message in front of me, however, was far too real, bolded and underlined like I was short-sighted. It was still a kick in the face even when I'd known it was coming. The words were firm and to the point. No sugarcoating. Urgent. I flinched at the string of exclamation marks. Did they really need that many? My eyes went funny, blurring around the edges after reading and rereading the content multiple times. Immediate eviction notice for Lou Thompson on 10/15/21. Below that, in the smallest font possible: please visit the campus office to arrange alternative housing. If you want to appeal your notice, please ring the admin office. Open Mondays, Fridays 9-5. Gripping the eviction notice between my fingers, I had to bite back a sob. So there had been a warning that had been hidden. I wasn't really surprised. My housemates regularly stabbed each other in the back. Isaac was the usual suspect. Imagine Randolph from Recess and make him an adult. He'd gotten a girl thrown out in the first month for smoking in her room. I waved the paper, my eyes burning with tears. It wasn't fair. Isaac was a trust fund kid with his own private bathroom. He didn't know or care about the ramifications, only that he was doing the right thing. How long has this been here? Dunno. Isaac's response was flippant. You know Hannah. She loses things all the time. I felt my cheeks blaze. Isaac, how long have you known about this? He hesitated. It was on the countertop when I got back from class. Look, don't blame me. You're the one who's been dodging paying rent. I've gotta go. Okay, I think the campus office is open so you should be able to make it. I could sense his smug smile. It's going to drop pretty low tonight. Lou, you know how bad it gets in Canada this time of year. I'm so sorry you didn't get the eviction notice. Right, I could see my breath when I let out a sharp sob I couldn't hold in anymore. I had to hug myself to stay warm, but my sweater wasn't helping. It was so fucking cold, I just wanted to go to bed. Can I at least get my jacket? I don't think that would be a good idea, Lou. I'd be breaking the rules. Go fuck yourself. That's what I wanted to spit. Instead, though, I forced myself to smile despite my world crumbling around me. I wouldn't give him the satisfaction of knowing he'd gotten to me. Glancing at my phone, the time was treading towards 5. Thankfully, it didn't start snowing until I was pushing through the old wooden doors of the student help office, located on the edge of campus. The building was ancient and crumbling. When I stepped inside, a welcome blast of heat hit me in the face and I felt marginally better. Sitting behind the front desk was a woman, maybe in her mid-50s, frowning at a laptop. In front of her was a dog-eared copy of War and Peace and an overflowing cup of coffee. I didn't know what looked more pathetic, me, trying not to cry while hugging warmth into myself, or the dying plant near the door I almost knocked over. I headed over to the desk and rehearsed the words in my head. But when the woman's gaze flicked from her book to me, my mind blanked. Oh, hello. The woman greeted me with a wide smile and folded the page of her book before putting it down. Are you all right? Her smile pricked into a frown. Where on earth is your coat? I'm fine, I said, trying to maintain composure. I've been evicted from my student room. Her eyes widened. What's your ID number? 135,670. I said, and she typed into her laptop. Lou Thompson. She said, very flowery. I knew she was trying to keep me calm, but I was running purely on fight or flight. Thanks. The woman didn't seem to mind my response. Her eyes fixed on her laptop screen. Ah, yes. It seems you've been removed from the tenure agreement. She lifted her eyes to me. You received an eviction notice 3 days ago, notifying you of action being taken due to 2 missed payments despite signing a contract. The woman must have seen my expression, quickly changing her tone. Oh, I'm just reading what's on the screen. I'm sorry. This is all quite doom and gloom. Give me a moment, please. I watched her frenzied typing before her eyes found mine once more. Unfortunately, the main office is closed now, where I would normally be able to get in touch with someone who can help with your case. They'll be open first thing tomorrow. She trailed off. Which will not help in your case. You need somewhere to go tonight. Her eyes danced between her laptop and her coffee mug before her lips broke out into a reassuring smile. Don't worry, Lou. There are protocols in place for your type of situation. We call it emergency housing and no, it's not as scary as you might think. Emergency housing. The woman nodded enthusiastically. Yes, basically. If a student is left with nowhere else to go or is in a vulnerable situation, we put them into what we call emergency housing, which is just a broader term for a temporary placement. What we do is visit the student houses, dorms if it's our last option, and we put you with tenants willing to have another housemate for the night. You're not the first student to go through this, Lou. And certainly will not be the last. She stood and shut down her laptop, her hands sifting through piles of paper. Give me a moment. I have the applications around here somewhere. I felt my stomach curl into itself when the woman held up a piece of paper. Just write down your situation and sign at the bottom. I didn't move for a moment. I couldn't help taking notice of her grabbing her jacket and pulling it on. The idea of walking around in minus temperatures, begging strangers to let me stay the night, made me feel sick to my stomach. I'm okay, I said. I can. My dad actually lives down the road. The lady paused in grabbing her things. Lou, if your father lived down the road, why would you be here? Opening my mouth to argue, I realized there was no point. I grabbed the application form and the pen and wrote my name, and then 3 lines describing that I'd been kicked out. When I was done, the receptionist was making her way towards me, carrying a jacket and a can of something. I'll do the talking, don't worry. It's just for one night so we can get you some more permanent housing sorted out. She handed me the jacket and I managed a grateful smile. When I pulled it on, the sleeves were a little too long but it was perfect. The woman acted like my grandma, zipping it up and thrusting the can she'd been carrying into my hands. Upon closer inspection, I realized it was what looked like a canned hot chocolate. I couldn't tell because the text was in Japanese. The woman beamed. She was pulling on a pair of gloves. I cracked open the can and took an experimental sip. She waited for my reaction, her smile widening. My son recently moved to Japan and sent me these. At first I wasn't sure. But between you and me, Lou, I can't stop drinking them. I was sure the drink was supposed to be heated. But it wasn't bad. Maybe sweeter than normal chocolate milk. But I liked it. I drained half the can while the woman hurried around the office like a frantic wasp. She talked to me conversationally, grabbing her bag and keys. I wasn't surprised when Joey moved to Japan. My great-grandmother was a powerful seer. Our family has been in touch with the spirit world for a while. Joey was a businessman for 20 years and was unhappy. When he told me he was following his dreams and moving to North Japan with several friends, she didn't stop talking the whole time. Her words weren't quite registering, though they were comforting. I tried to smile when she switched off the lights in the office and took me back through the entrance, leading outside. There wasn't too much snow on the ground, but the air was icy and cruel, whipping my cheeks. I quickly learned the woman's name was Jane, though her stories became more of a white noise when we reached the first house. It wasn't a long walk, thankfully. When the door opened and a half-asleep girl peered out, Jane didn't even get to speak. Her gaze fell on me and she rolled her eyes. "We're full," she said before shutting the door in our faces. The second house wasn't much better. Frat boys who invited us to a party instead. I'd lost count of how many people had turned us away. Some people were nice, but firm. The fourth or fifth house was small and homely, maybe Victorian. There was no garden, except from a small patch of grass which looked like it had seen better days. The house was different from the other properties. This one seemed older. There was a set of stone steps I had to drag myself up. "I have a good feeling about this one." Jane nudged me, flashing me a smile. I could only manage a nod, frowning at the ivy twisted up old red brick. Jane knocked three times, and I held my breath when the door finally opened, spilling golden light. There was a figure, but I refused to look up and face another rejection. Jane started to speak, before the tenant let out an exaggerated sigh. "I've got the door." The guy seemed to be talking to someone inside. I detected an accent. It was strong, Australian. When I plucked up enough courage to look up, there was a kid poking his head through the door. A guy. The first thing I noticed was his hair. A mop of red curls hanging in shadowed eyes. His skin was pale and the contrast with his hair was appealing in ways I couldn't really explain. Everything about him struck me as warm, cozy. Maybe it was the golden light spilling around him from the hallway or his expression, but I instantly knew this house was different. There were no judgmental eyes or tight lips. The guy looked at us. He wasn't smiling, but the muscles in his face were twitching into one. "I don't suppose any of you have a fajita-style double cheese on ya?" Jane looked confused. She sent me a panicked look I could only frown at. "It's a joke," he said, leaning against the doorframe and folding his arms. "You know, funny, haha." Jane laughed too, a little forced. Oh, a joke. Aw, yes, that's very funny." She looked at her list, which she was barely clinging onto. The icy air was cruel, trying to snatch it from her grasp. "You must be a tenant of number 24. Good evening." "Oh, goodness. There's no name on here." "You must be." The guy cut her off. "Just call me boy," he said, with a shrug. "Sup? Hello. Well, my name is Jane Cleese. I work at the emergency housing department and this young lady has had a bad day. She doesn't have any place to go and it's my job to find her emergency housing. Would you be so kind to allow her to stay the night? You and the other two tenants will be fully compensated. And really, she's a lovely girl. It's only temporary until first thing tomorrow morning." While she spoke, I kept my eyes on my sneakers. I could feel my cheeks getting progressively warmer, my gut twisting itself into a frenzy. When Jane continued on, the words fell into nullity in my mind. I'd heard them so many times. They didn't even mean anything anymore. "Sure." His words surprised me, and I looked up. Jane's eyes snapped to the boy, a smile breaking out on her lips. "Oh, that would be wonderful." She nudged me with her elbow. "See, I knew we'd find you somewhere." "What a kind young man." The guy chuckled. "Sure. She can stay. As long as she doesn't piss and shit everywhere." Jane looked mildly horrified and the guy sighed, widening the door. "Another joke." That time I did meet his eyes, and they were laughing. Everything about him was laughing, and the knot in my gut began to unravel. He gestured inside. "Come on in. We have a spare room, so you're welcome to have that. The door is kinda janky and the wardrobe is a little too small if you have a lot of stuff, but we can get you another one. As for Wi-Fi, laundry, and food, you're free to use it as long as you contribute a little, though there's no pressure." His accent was so strong I was struggling to fully make out what he was saying. "We have a games console and it's shared, but if you can wait like 5 hours or more for a turn, and you've managed to wrestle the controller off of Connor, you're all good." I replayed what he was saying in my head and every conclusion I came to was the same. The kid was speaking like I was staying for longer than a night. Jane seemed to be thinking the same thing. Oh, can she stay a little longer? She said excitedly. Obviously. We won't push past one night, though it would work in our favor. It's going to take me at least a few days to process the application. The guy nodded easily, again cutting Jane off. I mean, if she wants to. We've been wanting a new housemate for a while actually. Jane turned to me, her eyes wide. Is that okay with you? Yeah, I said, avoiding the guy's amused smile. Jane was ecstatic. When she turned to the guy, though, her expression seemed to dampen for a second. Her smile, however, didn't disappear. The woman chuckled lightly, her gaze suddenly going to the sheet of paper in her hand. It appears I've done it again. When she turned to me, her smile wasn't quite as bright and chipper. It's a lovely house, sweetheart, Jane said. I'll leave you to get settled. Okay, call me if you need anything. She didn't look up from her list when she said goodbye. I opened my mouth to thank her, but the woman had already disappeared back down the steps and straight into the dark. When her footsteps had faded, I had half a mind to follow her. I was staring after her when the guy laughed. It was a good laugh. I found myself liking it. What's up with her? He poked his head further into the snow falling around us, dancing flakes landing on thick strands of red hair falling in warm brown eyes. She looks like she's seen a ghost. She's just cold. Uh-huh. The guy clucked his tongue. Well, as much as I love standing out in the freezing cold, can we move this introduction to the inside? Please. He gestured me through the door. You coming? Yeah, I managed a smile, stepping into a brightly lit hallway. I was automatically hit with warmth, an intense warmth that settled my jumping gut. The house was old-fashioned, but the good kind, with rustic colors decorating the hallway. Every door was rich mahogany, and the carpet a maroon color which complemented a cream ceiling. The walls matching. When the guy twisted an ornate doorknob leading into the main hall, I couldn't help looking around in awe, drinking everything in. It was like stepping back in time. I found my words somewhere between kicking off my shoes and stumbling after the guy. Thanks for, he turned, a smile curving on his lips. It's no prob, man. If I'm honest, I'm just doing it for brownie points from Bits. She's been wanting a female housemate for a while, and it's my turn to wash up tonight. He shot me a grin as he jumped up a rickety-looking staircase which looked ready to crumble. I figured if I bring her some new meat, I'll get out of washing last night's lasagna pans. I could only offer a nervous laugh. All right, let's do this. Introductions. He leapt up the steps two at a time, but I hesitated. He must have seen my expression. I was frowning at the state of old ratty carpet barely clinging to the steps. That was an accident waiting to happen. I'm Levy, as you can tell by my voice. I'm not from around here. I'm originally from Victoria in Australia. I moved here to follow my dreams. You know, buskin' on the streets and all that. It turns out it's a lot harder than it looks, so I enrolled at CMU and here I am. When he reached the top of the stairs, Levy leaned over the banister while I dragged my bag up the rest. There were nails sticking out of each one. I hate bugs. Disney movies are my kryptonite. If you grind your teeth near me, I will shove my earphones in. And I have a passionate hatred for Olivia Rodriguez and take out plastic sporks. Rodrigo. I found myself correcting him when I caught up. Levy shot me a pained look. Don't tell me you're a fan too. She's a daily occurrence on the Alexa. Which song? All of them. Please save me. I laughed that time. And you? Huh? Your name? Oh, right. It's Lou. He whistled. Lou. Nice to meet ya, Lou. Welcome to our humble, if not slightly messy, abode. Levy led me down a small hallway with light green walls which again were homely. He pointed to doors as he went. Bathroom. There's one downstairs too, but the faucet doesn't work. Then we have my bedroom at the end of the hallway. Next to that are Connor and Bitsy's. And finally yours. He patted a heavy wooden door with a brass handle. I nodded and headed towards it, but his hand was on my shoulder, gently leading me back down the hall. Levy pointed to a small alcove leading into a brightly lit room I couldn't fully see. That's the kitchen, for all your kitchen needs. As you would have probably guessed, we're all Michelin-style chefs. So, expect gourmet dishes such as cremated pepperoni pizza. He led me through another door. This time the room was dark, lit up by a TV screen mounted on the wall. There was a game playing. I recognized it. Call of Duty. In front of the TV were two figures. One was slumped on a beanbag on the carpet, the other curled up on a ratty-looking brown couch. Just like the rest of the house, the lounge had so much personality. The decor was simple, white walls and red carpet, though it was the mess around me that I took in. There were clothes everywhere. On every available surface were piles of laundry. The glass table in the middle of the room was covered in board games and hardback books, empty coffee mugs and beer cans. When I stepped further into the room, the figures in front of the TV bled into real people. The orange bobble hat was the first thing I saw nestled on the girl's head. It sat on top of messy brown curls framing a heart-shaped face. Sitting a few meters away was a guy with bed hair who looked like he hadn't slept in days. Sleep circles shadowing dark eyes. Levy strode over to the guy and yanked the controller from him. When the boy let out a sound of protest, Levy cleared his throat. "Aren't you supposed to be writing your novel? I'm on a break." The boy groaned. "Come on, give it back. Bits is going to kill me." Levy shook his head, nodding to me. "These idiots are my housemates." He rolled his eyes. "Connor is the one failing at COD, and Bitsy's on the beanbag. Connor is a so-called writer. But he never actually writes, only telling people he's going to write. Bitsy is a temporary dropout who enjoys collecting potted plants and trying to be a vegan. So, clearly these guys are pretty interesting people." "Ha." The other guy, Connor, twisted around, shooting me a friendly smile. "Sup, did Levy kidnap you?" Bitsy dropped her controller and jumped up, rushing over and wrapping her arms around me. I got a whiff of lavender shampoo and whatever exotic plants she collected. The girl was a bundle of knitted cardigan and curly hair. "You got us a new housemate," she squeaked, pulling away. "And she's a girl." Levy shrugged. "Yeah, Bits. I just grabbed her off the street." "Funny." She rolled her eyes at the boy, throwing a cushion in his face. When Levy grabbed one, she dodged his assault, pulling me out of the way. "I'm Isadora. But those idiots call me Bitsy. The Itsy. Bitsy Spider," Connor said. "It's literally in the name." Bitsy glared at him. "You're lucky it's a cute nickname. You've just earned yourself washing up duty." Levy chimed in, switching off the TV. "Only because you're supposed to be doing it." "Well, yeah. I've got a serious headache coming on." "Shit hurts, man. You're on the rota, Levy." Connor murmured. "The rota never lies. Fuck the rota." "Anyway," Bitsy turned from the boys sparring to me. "What's your poison?" "Huh?" "She's asking you what you want to drink." Connor stretched and stood up. It's hard to understand Bitsy's private language, but we're getting there. When I first met her, she was just white noise in my ears. "Hey," Connor held out his hands to shield himself from a fluffy cushion aimed at his face. "You was little better than Levy." He laughed. His accent took me a while to get used to. Levy scoffed. "You're just jealous because I actually know what the sun looks like." When Bitsy grabbed my arm and pulled me into the kitchen to make coffee, I felt like I was home. The kitchen was smaller than the lounge with a table and some chairs, and the usual appliances scattered around. I stood in the doorway frowning at an empty glass on the table while Bitsy rifled through the cupboards. "Do you like Tim Tams?" Bitsy held up a pack. "Levy's mom sends them from NZ. Don't tell him I gave you one." She dropped two in front of me and took a bite out of one, grinning through a mouthful. I nodded and popped half of one into my mouth, reveling in the burst of chocolate. I took a sip of coffee, though I wasn't ready for the sludge that dripped down my throat. It was freezing. The milk was sour. Badly sour. I had to force it down. So, they were scatterbrained and forgot to change milk. I could deal with that. Bitsy was an energy I couldn't keep up with. "Since Levy's abandoned his tour, I'll continue it." She showed me the remaining rooms, ending on what looked like a games room. "We're looking to turn this into some kind of office for Connor's writing. When we have permission from the landlord, of course. But right now it's just sort of where we play games, mostly Monopoly, where it becomes a sort of war zone between the boys. But I love them. They're like my brothers. You know," she folded her arms with a sigh. "Like, I want to kill them most of the time, but then we play Smash all night and get wasted. And then they're my best friends." "Heard that?" Levy's voice floated from the kitchen. "I'm selling you so you seem actually tolerable." "Are you kidding?" A loud splash. "I have a great personality." A little later on, I was given a proper introduction to my room. It was bigger than the one I had at my last house, and the bed was huge. I fell asleep pretty much as soon as my head hit warm sheets. I didn't dream, but it was a peaceful sleep, though I didn't sleep for long. I was woken by an intense nausea in the pit of my gut. You know, the urge to throw up that makes your mouth water. I had that tenfold. I remembered Levy talking about two bathrooms. There was one on the hallway, and then one downstairs. I had to get to the bathroom before the spoiled milk I drank earlier made an unwelcome reappearance. According to my phone, it was nearing midnight. I was still in my clothes from earlier, and when I stepped out of my room, I had to wrap my arms around myself. It was so cold. The bathroom was exactly where Levy said it was, but when I pulled at the silver handle, it was locked. Who locked a bathroom? The house was quiet. I figured the others were asleep or working in their rooms. The sickly feeling was getting worse. I found myself in the kitchen grabbing a glass of water, but I couldn't swallow it down properly. At the back of the kitchen was another door with peeling paint and a broken handle. Bitsy had vaguely referred to it as the basement. I knew as I stood there that there was no way I was going to make it downstairs. and barfing in someone else's kitchen when you're a guest was practically a violation. I was yanking open the door and stumbling down stone steps before I could stop myself. The basement was bigger than I'd imagined, lit up with eerie mellow light. My first priority was finding somewhere I could barf and then clean it up after. Instead, though, my gaze first went to a flickering bulb spewing dying light, and then what was in the middle of the room, like an attraction, like it had been waiting for me to see it. At first I thought it was just that, an attraction, or maybe statues. The house was old, so it made sense my new housemates would haul the weird shit to the basement. When I got closer, though, I realized I was staring at two chairs back to back, and slumped on them, two figures. My steps halted when something slammed into me. It was nothing physical. It was a smell so intense, choking my nose and writhing in the back of my throat. I had to slam my hand over my mouth. The smell started to make sense, though, in a sick kind of way. It made sense in my head because what I was seeing sent the sour milk I'd forced down earlier erupting up my throat. I felt my body, my entire being, go icy cold, just like in the lounge earlier. It was the vividness of the orange hat that had attracted me to her, and when she'd turned around and smiled at me, the whole room seemed to light up with her. Now though, that same hat sat on limp brown curls, hanging in closed eyes. When I got close enough to fully take in the scene, my brain refused to register it. Bitsy, but not just Bitsy, behind her, I glimpsed familiar red curls in a plaid shirt, pale skin and freckles, everything I'd taken in earlier. Drinking him in and seeing him as warm and cozy, the poster boy for life, considering the twinkle in his eyes and the grin stretched across his mouth. Levy, it couldn't be him, couldn't be them, I thought, but I knew what I was seeing was real. They were dead. I don't know how to explain this to you. I don't want to, but I need you to believe me. The two of them were dead. My brain refused to take several things in, like the pool of congealed red at their feet, at Levy's hands bound to the chair and the pool of hardened crimson on the floor in front of him, his curls matted with that same shade, that disgusting, cruel shade of red that painted them. But not just that, because if they were just dead, my story wouldn't exist. Lou, his voice was soft. I knew he was behind me, but I refused to look. Instead, I looked at the real him, at skin that had been gray for days, and eyes that hadn't opened in a while. When I took slow, stumbled steps and circled the grim scene, I found the reason why Levy's head was hurting so much. Just looking at the two of them sitting in the cold, their feet bare on concrete, blood painting them, I knew they'd suffered. They had hurt. The way Levy was angled, his body leaning back, chin hitting his chest. Bitsy, the smear of red decorating her chest, dyeing her pajama shirt. I staggered back one step, and then two. There was a voice at the back of my mind. Connor, I thought dizzily. Where was Connor's body? Levy stepped in front of me, in front of his own body. His smile was still bright, his eyes on me. And only me. We should probably go back upstairs, he said. I expected his voice to break, for some inclination that he knew what he was in the presence of. It's getting kind of cold down here, don't you think? I couldn't move, couldn't breathe. No, I whispered. No, you're tired. Levy yawned. Come on, he'll be here soon. What? I let him drag me back upstairs, stumbling over every step I took. Once we were back in the kitchen, back in the light, Levy laughed nervously. Yeah, we also happened to have a poltergeist. He gingerly stroked the back of his head, and I was starting to see it. Now the facade was crumbling. The true nature of the three of them began to bleed through. I was staring at the hole in the back of his head. Levy caught my stare. What is it? Nothing. It was nothing, but I couldn't say it. Connor collapsed into a chair with a sigh. Yeah, he's pretty annoying. We either stay in our rooms or ride it out together. Bitsy wandered in clutching a stuffed toy. Annoying is an understatement. I didn't know what to say. I watched as the three of them grabbed onto each other. Levy covered Bitsy's ears, and Cole rested his head in his lap. I was waiting for something to happen, for one of them to suddenly start talking, start telling me what the fuck was going on, before the kitchen door flew open. Connor, a voice thundered, though it was echoey, rumbling around the room. But there was nobody there. Levy's eyes were squeezed shut, Bitsy whimpering. I sensed it around me, an energy I couldn't explain. I can't even write it down. There was a shadow on the wall creeping across neat paintwork. Where is it? Where's the fucking manuscript? Connor's voice. What the hell are you doing here? Get out of our house. Bitsy's shriek. I heard it loud and clear, watching the real Bitsy squeeze Levy's hands over her ears tighter. The girl was trembling, and the two boys seemed to lean into her, forming a protective barrier. Okay. Connor's voice hissed. I'll get it. Just don't hurt them. It's got nothing to do with them. A laugh, and chills crept down my spine. Well, get it, then. The kitchen lights above me flickered, on and off. I could almost feel them, these past versions. I could feel their fear, their pain and anger as more and more shadows bled into existence. The man's voice was back. Louder. Thanks, Connor. I appreciate it. You know, you could have made it. You showed me this every week. Every fucking week. And I'm ashamed to say I started to wonder why I bothered. Why? I've been trying for years, and some 19-year-old comes and blows me out of the water. You've got talent, kid. You could have gone somewhere. A pause. And I knew his next words before they came out of phantom lips I couldn't see. It's a real shame you're not going to be writing anything else. I couldn't listen to it. I wanted to run. I wanted to get out, because I knew what was coming. What I'd seen. No, Levy's voice this time. No, you said. You said you wouldn't hurt us. I lied. Now, follow me. If you try anything, I'll give Itsy Bitsy a frontal lobotomy. Instead of listening to their phantom voices panicking, begging, crying out for help, I focused on the real them huddled together and what was going on around me. The first gunshot sent the refrigerator flying across the room. A bottle of soda on the countertop exploding. The second and third gunshots completely animated the kitchen. Like it was alive. I had to duck when cupboards started opening and shutting. Packs of chips and Tim Tams hitting the wall. They were doing it. I realized, my foggy thoughts coming to some kind of awareness. Levy wrapped his arms around Bitsy. And Connor shoved his head in her shoulder. When it was over. When phantom footsteps ran back up the basement stairs and made a run for it, the door slamming behind them. The three of them relaxed, and the whirlwind around me came to a grinding halt. Levy. Bitsy and Connor pulled away from each other with a breath. See, Levy slowly lifted his head and shot me a sickly smile. Poltergeist. I couldn't breathe before the words were leaving my mouth. I didn't mean for them to sound so final. So blunt, so wrong. And yet they did. You're dead. I managed to whisper. Oh God, you're dead. His eyes darkened. Another bottle of soda burst behind him. He didn't even blink. We're not dead. I told you, we have a poltergeist. No, I saw you. I heard you. I tried to run. Though I'd only gotten halfway before I felt my feet leave the ground. It suddenly felt like I'd lost control of my body. Before I could speak, before I could breathe. I was slamming back into the door. Pain rumbled in the back of my head. A neutron star collision exploding in the backs of my eyelids. Levy strode over to me. What did I say? I said we're not dead. So fucking drop it. I didn't reply. How could I reply? So, relax, he said. Are you going to chill out, Lou? I should go. I said, pawing for the handle on the door and pulling it open. My mom lives not far from here. Connor folded his arms. He casually inclined his head and the door slammed shut. Yeah, we're not buying that. Bitsy pouted. I thought you wanted to live here. She is living here. Levy said, Lou is our new housemate. She's going to live with us and we're going to be happy. Okay, we're going to be a family. His lips pricked into a smile. Right, Lou? No, I said. No, I can't be here. I need to get someone. I need to get you help. I'm not sure how I got from point A to point B. I remember running. I remember Bitsy's expression. The hurt flashing in her eyes. But I kept running. I made it to the top of the stairs before a screeching wail hit my ears and I almost lost my footing. Wait, it was Bitsy. She was screaming. A banshee wail rattling my skull. I felt it fill me, reaching into my brain and stabbing repeatedly. When I reached the bottom of the stairs, something warm and wet dripped from my nose. But I was in flight mode. I had to get out. Dead, I thought hysterically. Staggering to the main door, the whole time I'd known them. I'd talked to them, laughed with them, even considering to make my move impermanent. They were the first people I'd met who felt like natural friends. Like they wanted to make an effort to know me, to take that step nobody else had bothered to since high school. And they were dead. Levy, he was blocking the door, by the way he was angling his body. I knew it was more than that. The power he had, all three of them had already trapped me inside the house's walls. Lou, Levy sounded out of breath. Just, hold on, hear us out. I couldn't, not when their bodies were in the basement, not when I'd heard their deaths. He laughed, and it was that real laugh. The one that I'd found myself liking. We have a poltergeist, yes. He sucks, yes, but it's just for a few minutes every night. And we mostly ignore it. His eyes were bright. Manic as he searched my expression for understanding. Something happened here. The house is haunted. And I swear to you, you're safe. They don't hurt us. They just make noise. The more he laughed, the crazier the lights were getting around me. On, off, on, off. Levy's expression broke my heart. He was desperate. A subconscious part of his mind, deep down begging me to believe the lie he was telling himself to suppress what really happened to him. Okay, I whispered. I believe you. The boy cocked his head like a child, Say it. His voice broke around the words. Say we have a poltergeist. He held out his hand, palm out. And a stranglehold was suddenly around my neck, twisting, twisting, phantom fingers squeezing my windpipe. I felt him, the energy snaking around him, choking the breath from my lungs. My feet lifted slowly off the ground once again. And I found myself flying. I'd always wanted to fly. But doing just that, hovering in the air, my body levies to play with, I took it back. You have a poltergeist. And his hands curled into a fist. And I felt all of the oxygen leave my lungs. I'll stay. I choked, my vision blurring. Levy dropped his hands and I followed suit. Hitting the floor with a thud, his lips formed a smile that I wanted to say was warm. Was friendly, like earlier. But I didn't see warmth. I didn't see friendliness. I saw a monster who was in denial of being one. Good. The light stopped flickering. Welcome home, Lou.